yesterday, so that's what that is. Moving on. I'm the branch membership officer for Unison West Midlands Community Branch in Birmingham. Actually, we're based in Wolverhampton. We've got about 5,000 members, mainly working in housing and care. And as a branch, we've taken a position of trying to raise debate about basic income within Unison. And so far, we're discussing it at regional level, and we're hoping next year to get the union to debate a national policy position on basic income. So this evening, I'm going to be facilitating the meeting, and just presently, I'll introduce our guest panel. First of all, I wanted to set the scene with a very quick introduction to the topic. What is basic income? For anyone that's not aware, it's a payment that's given to everyone unconditionally, with no strings attached, in essence as a human right, and it's sufficient to cover the basics for survival. And it's an idea with quite a long history, spanning many parts of the world, but it's also currently getting a bit of a revival for a number of reasons. And so right now it's popping out in some pilot studies in Finland, the Netherlands, Canada as well, lots of interest in it. South Africa and Nigeria as well. Switzerland, of course, they're having an actual referendum on it next year, which is where I first learned about the idea. In Germany, they have a crowdfunded version for Mein Grundeinkommen, and they've just paid out a basic income to the 22nd person through that scheme. And in the US, they're just starting a similar one, and they're working towards crowdfunding for their first basic income for someone. There's also been work done looking at different complementary currencies. Some of that's even happened as close to home as in Scotland, which is interesting. And of course, it's been tried already in several pilot studies in a few places with some really good effects. So famous ones in Namibia and India. And some comparable schemes, it's not a full basic income, but it's still interesting to look at in places like Alaska. And there's a Cherokee casino that shares out some of the takings to the community, which has been written about quite a lot as well. Coming back to the UK, we've got two organisations in the UK that are working on promoting basic income. There's Basic Income UK, which was put on this evening's meeting, and the Citizens Income Trust. So Basic Income UK grew up to push the European Citizens Initiative for Basic Income in 2013. And this was an effort to gather a million signatures across Europe. And we fell slightly short of that. The actual number achieved was 300,000 signatures, over 10,000 of which are from the UK. This was actually the most successful European Citizens Initiative that lacked the support of really major, large organisations like big unions, so still quite a good achievement there. And so Basic Income UK has continued after that effort came to an end, and it's essentially a campaigning organisation. We're very grateful for the existence of the Citizens Income Trust, which is slightly different. It's an educational charity. They've done years' worth of research on basic income, lots of costings, and they've been keeping the idea alive for a very long time. So, just in summary, there's definitely a worldwide movement building around the issue of basic income now, very actively, especially in America and Canada, taking big strides into getting it into public discussion with policymakers. More and more organisations are coming out in favour of the idea. So we're not alone here talking about it. We've got a context of massive welfare cuts, very much an agenda in the media of negativity towards people receiving welfare. And at the same time, a looming environmental crisis, which means that we need the ability to refuse work that's damaging either for ourselves or for the planet. Lots of technological changes coming up that are going to impact on employment, and lots of questions around what kind of growth, what type of growth do we want, should we have for the future? So that's just setting the scene slightly. What I'm going to do now is introduce our guests, who are each going to kick off with 5 or 10 minutes each of their own views. Then we'll have a bit of a panel backwards and forwards, and there'll be lots of time for you guys in the audience to also chime into the discussion later on. So this evening we're joined by musician Brian Eno, the financial writer, economist and singer Francis Coppola, and the anthropologist and activist David Graeber. Welcome to all three of you. Thank you for coming. Really pleased to have you with us. And Brian, would you like to begin?
Thank you. I suppose the subject that interests me most of all, really, the thing that I think about most, is waste. And what I think about in particular is the waste of human potential. And as time goes on, I become more and more aware of that, of how many people are not using themselves well, because they can't, because the circumstances don't encourage them to do so, because there's no demand for what they can offer. Now, if you're a follower of Ayn Rand, you wouldn't be worried about that at all. That would be part of the ecology of the system. That kind of inequality would be where the energy of the system comes from, in your opinion. And in fact, a lot of the people who are currently pulling the strings are followers of Ayn Rand. She's a very important philosopher to the Silicon Valley people. A lot of them are Ayn Rand followers. Alan Greenspan was an Ayn Rand follower. There are plenty of them in high places. I'll just read something that I found just before I came that Ayn Rand said. Any group is only a number of individuals. If any civilization is to survive, it's the morality of altruism that men have to reject. So, it's, to me, a very kind of naive Darwinism, which doesn't allow for the fact that we aren't unconscious organisms. We're conscious. As soon as consciousness enters the picture, Darwinism doesn't work anymore. Even Darwin knew that, but Ayn Rand and people like her didn't actually read that part of the book. It's a bit later than the main, the punchline. But what I've felt for a very long time is that the great man theory of history, which proceeds directly from the Ayn Randian approach, because the Randian approach is that there are great individuals who distinguish themselves, push forward, and then pull the rest of humanity along with them, as though the rest of humanity is a kind of relatively inert working class, a serving class, and that there are a few distinguished people who, through the sheer power of will and intellect and whatever genes they happen to end up with, pull the rest of the world forward. This is almost the opposite of what I think. I think, although great new ideas are usually articulated by individuals, they're nearly always generated by communities. And I think what I see is the waste that we make of that possibility of cooperative intelligence. I made a word for this idea a long time ago. Being an artist, you hear a lot of talk about genius, which is the process of singling out certain people in art history and saying those were the important ones, you know, Picasso, Rembrandt, Shostakovich, whatever. Whenever you look at any of those artists, you find that they lived and drew from a very, very active, flourishing cultural scene. And they were only one of the elements in that scene. Picasso, for example, was stealing from everyone he could. I don't blame him. I'm not criticizing him for it. But, you know, he was very, very well aware of what everybody else was doing. And he was picking it up and distilling it and doing his own shuffle on it. And similarly with Rembrandt and Shostakovich and Beethoven and everybody else, all these people who are called genius actually sat in the middle of something that I call scenius, S-C-E-N-I-U-S. So just as genius is the creative intelligence of an individual, scenius is the creative intelligence of a community. And what I want to see is more attention given to that possibility of creative behavior. So what that means, of course, is two things, and they're both the opposite of Ayn Randianism. Is that what we call her?
Yeah.
Randianism.
Randianism.
Randianism. Yeah. One of them is the understanding that all people are born unequal, so everybody has a particular and unique set of gifts and talents, whatever they are. And secondly, that intelligence is generated by communities, by cooperation of some kind. So I suppose the thing about the biggest obstacle to that at the moment is that people have to earn a living. I often get asked to come and talk at art schools, and I rarely get asked back, because the first thing I always say is, I'm here to persuade you not to have a job. And the professors always look a bit nervous, since they often consider that their task is to somehow smooth you into a job. So my first message to people is, try not to get a job. That doesn't mean try not to do anything. It means try to leave yourself in a position where you do the things that you want to do with your time, and where you take maximum advantage of your whatever your possibilities are. And I suppose the obstacle is that, of course, most people aren't in a position to do that. So I want to do anything to work to a future where everybody is in a position to do that. Marx talked about it, and he talked about a time of superabundance when people measured their achievement not by the amount of time they spent at work, but by the amount of time they spent doing things other than working. And that's what I would like to see, that kind of reversal. So I should say that in terms of basic income, I probably know less about the subject than anybody else here in terms of how it would technically and economically work. This is what I'm hoping Francis is going to tell us.
I might not.
but what I do know is that the concept is the closest thing I've heard to achieving the kind of future that I would like to live in. Thank you.
Well, interestingly enough, I started off looking at this from a similar standpoint to Brian, because after all, I'm a singer, and that's what I was first. And I guess I've spent a lot of my life trying not to have a job and finding myself having to have a job in order to pay the bills, and finding myself less able to sing, or at times doing too much singing, which is another issue, purely in order to pay the bills. Both of those extremes, doing too much, doing so much of something that you love that you no longer love it, and it starts to hurt you instead of building up and rejuvenating you. Or the alternative, which is not doing enough of it and spending all your time doing something else for money, in my case, teaching other people to sing and never singing myself. In the end, it's soul-destroying, and it's a huge waste of talent, it's a huge waste of ability. And I have been persistently shocked over the last few years, as an economist, by the shocking waste of human talent, human capital, and I would say a growing waste, a growing number of people who are forced into jobs that don't work with their skills and their abilities and their desires, but that they are forced into doing simply in order to earn a living. This seems to me to impoverish not only them, but us as a society. Looking ahead, though, how I actually got into writing about basic income in the first place was back about 3 years ago, when I wrote a piece on my own blog called The Changing Nature of Work, when I started looking at the way in which work in our society is changing, and particularly looking at the what we might call the third technological revolution, the third industrial revolution, and the way in which that's changing patterns of working, the move towards the service economy, the automation of production, whereby we can make stuff for almost nothing with very little human intervention. So all the people who in the past lived their lives producing stuff on production lines, or before that, produced stuff in the mills or out in the fields. They're not going to produce stuff anymore, because actually we can automate it extensively. And I found myself thinking, if work is changing so much, if we're going to change towards a society in which we don't spend our lives making stuff, we don't produce in order to eat anymore, production is something that is done by machines, then what is it that people will do, and how does that relate to work as we know it? And I found myself thinking, actually, if we can produce the means to survive for nearly nothing, then people can do whatever they like. But what we need to do is to make sure that the proceeds from the production of all those machines is equitably distributed so that all people have the means to live. And there are good capitalist reasons for doing that kind of distribution, and that is that if all your robots are owned by Mark Zuckerberg, and he gets all the proceeds, then who is going to buy the production of all these robots? Where are they going to get the money? So there were good reasons for making sure that even in a capitalist society, resources, the proceeds of production were far more equitably distributed so that people had the means to live. And I found myself writing, to my complete astonishment, this would be achieved by having a basic income. And I looked at that and thought, what have I just written? I went on from that to look at this in more detail. I found myself writing, I wrote a chapter in Nesta's book on robot society, visioning that our work here is done, visions of a robot future. I wrote the section on labour markets and the disruption to traditional ways of thinking about labour and the interaction between employers looking for workers and workers looking for work for employers, and the way in which that is disrupted. And I remember writing a piece about wastefulness of automation, the way in which others were very careful automating production, even automating services as well, which is another growing trend, could actually leave us with an awful lot of people on the scrap heap. And actually, as I said, that impoverishes us collectively as a society. So again, I found myself going in the same direction. We need a basic income so that all these people who are no longer needed to make stuff and to do what David calls bullshit jobs and grunt jobs and the jobs that people don't actually like doing very much could be freed up to do things that are actually far more creative and far benefit us far more as a society at the cost of a basic income. It seemed to me this was a win-win. And then, because I'm in my other life, I'm a financial writer as well, I found myself writing about, following on the financial crisis, about the need for safe assets in financial markets. This is a bit of an esoteric subject, so bear with me. And the fact that if you want people to, want investors to take risk, they have to have safety available too. So government debt, for example, forms like an anchor in financial markets, so investors in their portfolios can have like an anchor of safe assets, and then they're willing to take risks. Isn't the same true of people in their lives? That people who have some kind of anchor, some kind of security, some kind of constancy, are then able to do things, to take risks, to not have a job, that otherwise they would not be able to do, because they'd be constantly worried about where's the next meal going to come from. And I actually speak from experience on that. I have known what it's like not to know where the next meal is coming from. I have known what it's like to put creative things that I really want to do way down the priority list and give higher priority to things that I don't really want to do and don't make the best of me simply because I've got to earn a living. And I don't want other people to be in that position. And I think that if we could create a society in which everybody has the means to live guaranteed to them, then we will actually create a more entrepreneurial, a more exciting, a more vibrant, a more creative society, and ultimately one which is, in human terms, far more productive. And that is the economic argument. And it's interesting that one of the big arguments against basic income that I've heard is that it will cause inflation. Well, from where I come from, inflation is associated with a growing, vibrant, and dynamic economy. So basic income means we have more growth, we have more dynamic and creative activity, and that means we have a bit more inflation. I personally would welcome it. So that's where I stand, that's how I ended up where I am now, is looking at this from all sorts of different angles, and all the roads led in the same direction to the same place. And when you're led in the same direction, regardless of your starting point, I suppose you end up believing that where you end up is where you need to be. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Actually, my father was a plate stripper. He worked in a print shop all his life. My mother was a garment worker when she was younger, worked in factories. And I remember one time my father took me aside and he said, "You know, everything you see around us, this house we have, everything you see in it, I earned that with my own two hands, working 9 to 5 every day. You know, I would get up in the morning, I would go in, and it was my labor that brought you everything you see around you." He said, "David, it was horrible. Don't do that." "You got a real job." So I took his words to heart, and he said, "Become an academic or something." And in a way, my embrace of basic income is also something I kind of learned from him. A lot of people think, "Well, you know, aren't you supposed to be an anarchist? Why would you be for basic income? Isn't that like giving more power to the government?" And, you know, I am anti-state. Sometimes I wish I hadn't actually used the word anarchist, because most people like anarchist ideas a lot more than they like the name anarchist. But in fact, you know, when I think about how I became one, it largely has to do with, again, my father's experiences. He fought in Spain, he was in the international brigades. And he always felt that what happened in Spain was one of the great social experiments. He was in Barcelona during the revolution there. Their idea of industrial reform was quite simple. They simply got rid of all white-collar workers. Either fired them or shot them, depending on how they felt about them as individuals. And they discovered, you know, they didn't actually make a whole lot of difference. Most of the things done by white-collar workers could probably have been done, in fact, were done by factory workers or other members of the staff of the factory or the firm, you know, pretty much in 2 hours a week of spare time off of their shifts. So, you know, so I started wondering, what do those guys really do? I mean, what is the function of these people if you could do their job in a couple hours a week? And I realized that basically most white-collar workers just exist to make workers feel bad about themselves. That's essentially what they're doing. I realized that there's like huge classes of people. It's true of a lot of people in government, more and more as time goes on. You know, their real job is to make you kind of feel like you're inadequate, that you don't, you're undeserving. And I realized that, you know, that's what government does. All these neoliberal reforms, which are supposed to like put conditionalities on welfare and like make things more efficient, they're framed in this moralizing terms. And what they actually end up doing is, you know, creating these huge class of people to sort of monitor you and make you think you're just not doing a very good job in life. This must be incredibly stifling. And I finally came to the conclusion that, you know, what financialization is and bureaucratization are the same thing. That we live in a society which has become increasingly bureaucratic. We live in a society, we don't think of it that way. Because we've come to think of bureaucracy as something which is only really come from government. So civil servants are bureaucrats, but if you dress exactly the same way, act exactly the same way, do exactly the same thing for a private corporation, you're not a bureaucrat. You know, if you go to the Apple store to get your computer fixed and they say, "Yeah, your screen's broken. No, we can't fix it. You have to come back in a week and get an appointment with the guy to tell you your screen's broken." You know, that's not bureaucracy for some reason, even though it fits all the qualifications. So what's happened is we've got this incredibly bureaucratized society, where public and private, you know, public bureaucracies become more like private ones interlock with public ones. I mean, you know, who creates bank regulations? Is it the government? Is it the bank? But, you know, it's kind of both. You can't even tell the difference anymore between public and private bureaucracies. And these bureaucracies operate, you know, by creating all of these jobs where people are essentially, you know, telling you that value comes from paperwork rather than from anything anybody actually does. I think finance is just the peak of it. You know, it starts on a level where there's this guy sort of monitoring you to see if you're using all the rooms of your house correctly or taking care of your children correctly or, you know, all the sort of benefit, like fraud conditionality, and you know, people trying to decide whether you're actually married to someone or, so poor people are just constantly monitored by huge classes of people who are there just to make you feel bad about yourself and tell you you're not doing a good enough job in life. And then the middle class, there's audit culture, everything. You spend as much time, I mean, I know this from universities, you know, sort of assessing what it is you're doing than you spend actually doing it, like increasingly more time assessing it. And that's all the forms and paperwork, and value comes from paperwork more and more. And I think finance is just the peak of it. It's the idea that, like, you know, a securitized derivative is just a really, really, really fancy form of paperwork, which is the ultimate source of value. Right? So the people who have the most elaborate paperwork are going to create the most power and the richest and are the top of the pyramid. But it's, you know, it starts with the guy, you know, monitoring whether you're taking care of your children correctly, and it ends with the guy in the suit who's taking bets on how long it'll take you to default on your mortgage. But it's all part of the same thing. So I think, you know, a proper libertarian communist position, if an anarchist position, if you want to think of it that way, is how do we just get rid of these guys? If you think about it, the big problem is that the right wing has managed to grab the anti-bureaucracy issue. So if people hate bureaucrats, they vote for the right. But in fact, if you look at what happens, I call it the iron law of liberalism. Every time they say, oh, let's introduce market reforms and get rid of state interference and red tape and bureaucracy, what ends up, every single time that ever happens, what you end up is more regulations, more paperwork, and more bureaucrats than you've had before. I think this can be proved. I mean, there's like, I think there's 25% more bureaucrats in Russia right now than there were under the Soviet Union. Think about that, the economy's collapsed, but they still have more bureaucrats. So that's what liberal reforms always do. So what would be a, you know, a left-wing position that would like be anti-bureaucratic? I mean, we need to grab this. And I think it's pretty obvious. It's just like, fire all those guys and, you know, and give everybody the same amount of money. That'll work. And it'll reduce the size of government dramatically, because all those annoying people, they're like, you know, trying to make you feel bad about themselves. Well, you know, they'll get basic income too, so they can go off and become poets or musicians or, you know, do something useful with their lives. They'll be happier too. I don't really want to be doing that. So that whole sort of mountain of paperwork will just kind of collapse. So this is my proposal. And I think that it will be, it's based on a reassessment of the nature of work. And I think that this is what's really important. If you look at the history of basic income, I think it's really, it marks a point where we really need to reevaluate what it is that is valuable and meaningful about the things that we do every day. You know, when I first wrote that essay on bullshit jobs that I imagine many of you have heard of, I was trying to think about the terrible pain of all those people. Because you meet people all the time, you know, when you ask them what they do, they don't want to tell you at first. and then, you know, if you press the matter, get them a little drunk, they'll say, well, I don't really do anything, you know, I just go in and, I mean, you know, a monkey could do it in an hour, but I have to, like, I could probably design software that would do it, like, without anybody involved at all. Or I just write reports that some committee never reads, and I try to, you know. So those people, like, what must it be like for people like that going to work every day and feeling they make no contribution to society? What they do 8 hours a day, sometimes 10, is just useless. It's soul destroying. There must be this deep inner pain that people are feeling, but nobody can express it because they don't want to admit that they're not doing anything, especially to their boss. So I wrote this piece, and it went crazy. I mean, I actually, it was funny because I wrote it right before going off to the woods. I was going to take a vacation from the internet. I just had my phone. And And I started looking at it, and it was insane. Like, within 3 weeks, it had been translated into 17 different languages. There were people circulating it, and all these different industries, those people in the financial services industry saying, oh my God, this has crossed my desk 8 times just today, which shows just how much they're working, right? And so I thought, how did this happen? In the piece, I suggested that, to some degree, I don't think people in power want people to have leisure time. The thing that people in power fear the most is a population that, has basic security and time. I mean, that started to happen in the late 60s. And look what happened. They freaked out. I mean, you could actually see this. I've talked to people who are different, sort of ruling class think tanks at the time, and they said there was a lot of discussion, what's going to happen when robots replace all the jobs? We thought the hippies are bad. What happens when the entire proletariat turns into hippies? Oh my God, it's going to be a disaster. So there was a sort of panic and movement away from robotization and sort of space age technologies in general toward information technologies and technologies of social control. But that's what I read at the time. A lot of people said, this is kind of a conspiracy theory approach. So I thought, it's not the only thing going on. I think that another reason for this tendency to create all these jobs. And by the way, somebody did a survey. I felt very vindicated. I always assumed that the number of people who thought their jobs were worthless was about 25%, but YouGov did a survey. Your job makes a meaningful contribution to the world. 37% said no. Only 50% were absolutely sure that their job did something. 13% were not sure. But 37% were convinced their job did not actually do anything that needed to be done in any way. So think about that. So where does that come from? And I think what it really comes from is from a change in our idea of what it is that is meaningful about work. And I think this is what basic income can do, is if there's anything that can bring about a cultural transformation, which is desperately needed at this point, in that, basic income is it. I think in the 19th century, this actually relates to the idea of Stenius. Marx has always attributed ideas of communism, labor theory of value, from each according to their abilities to each according to their needs. It turns out he didn't make up any of this himself, really. They were just seemed to be the kind of things that were bouncing around in cafes at the time, from worker circles. And he kind of picked up and certainly integrated it in a brilliant way. But the idea of the labor theory of value just became common sense in the 19th century. I mean, if you look at even sort of mainstream politicians, I was looking at speeches by Abraham Lincoln, any of these people, they sound like Marxists now. Everybody's talking about how, all capital is derived from labor and labor must be given precedence, and so forth and so on. And so they have this notion that value comes from human labor. The problem is they had this also had this focus on production. That, the factory, when factory labor was seen as a sort of paradigm for all labor. It was very macho, guys smithing things and banging things and casting iron and so forth. It was a production line, perhaps, was the basic image. Whereas, of course, most labor is not actually productive, if you think about it. You make a glass once, right? But you wash it 1,000 times. Most labor isn't about making things. It's about keeping things the same, maintaining things, nurturing things, giving them an environment in which they can grow, caregiving, caretaking. So the sort of male focus led people to really neglect the fact what most labor actually consists of, and that made it possible for there to be a counteroffensive, an ideological counteroffensive, which you see people like Andrew Carnegie and the Robber Barons were very self-conscious. We need to change people's ideas about people don't define themselves through their work. They should define themselves as consumers. We need to change the idea of what production is all about. And so the new idea was that, production really comes from the minds of brilliant entrepreneurs who come up with these ideas. And you're just like little robots, making the stuff. That doesn't really add value. Okay. This is drawing too big. And that was possible with the factory emphasis. But then the question is, how do you validate work? You just say you go back to the Puritan idea. Work is valuable in itself. If you're not working really hard at something you don't like, you're not a very good person. You're a parasite. So that's how you can have the situation now where people actually think their work is more valuable if they don't get anything out of it.
So even if you like know that you're doing something good for the world, you know, in a way you should be paid less. People think it's okay, you know, like nurses should be paid less, or you know, because they're actually contributing, or teachers, because they're contributing to the world. So I think that we need to massively reevaluate this. If we're gonna take off again, we need to start thinking about what makes work actually valuable, which is that it's a form of care for other people. You know, it benefits people in a concrete way. And nobody can really decide how that happens other than the people doing it. So I think if we're going to try to have that conceptual revolution, which you know, can overcome this notion of job creators and that, you know, all everybody, left and right, you know, when they have, they're always calling for more jobs and more work. I think, you know, because the only way they can see people as valuable is that they're like doing something they don't like very much, whether or not there's any need for it. We caught ourselves in a conceptual trap, and I think only notions of basic income can like start us reevaluating what it is we actually value about what we do. Mm-hmm.